A $399 CoreXY printer with 4-color capability? Let's take a look at what's great, what's quirky, and what still needs some work. We'll get into it right after this. Hello, 3D printing friends. Today on the BB3D channel, we're taking a look at the FlashForge AD5X. Thanks to FlashForge for sending this over free of charge so we could all get a closer look at it. I'll run through the features and specs, talk a bit about the setup and overall workflow, show you a few test prints, and then wrap things up with what I like about it, what I don't, and where I think it could use some improvement. So what exactly is the FlashForge AD5X? At its core, see what I did there? It's a pretty basic CoreXY printer, about as bare bones as you can get. I mean, it's not going to win any design awards. Oh, I take that back. Well, anyway, it's a CoreXY printer with a build volume of 220 millimeters on the X, Y, and Z axes. The printer uses an open frame design. That's not ideal for higher temperature materials that really benefit from an enclosure, but it works really well for common filaments like PLA and PETG. The open frame also makes routine maintenance easy. Things like cleaning and lubricating the smooth rods, linear bearings, and the Z-axis lead screws. It has a 4-color or 4-material module that FlashForge calls the IFS, or Intelligent Filament System. There are 4 spring-loaded spool rewinders mounted on the side of the frame and 4 PTFE tubes feeding into a 4-in, 1-out toolhead. The toolhead has a quick-swap nozzle system, and the nozzle can reach up to 300 degrees Celsius. It also uses the nozzle itself as a bed probe, which helps with getting really good first layers. The bed uses a magnetic spring steel sheet with a double-sided textured PEI surface. That makes removing finished prints easy, and the bed can heat up to 110 degrees Celsius. Up front, there's a 4.3-inch color touchscreen, and it has both Ethernet and Wi-Fi connectivity. If you'd rather keep it off the network, there's a USB port on the side of the screen so you can print directly from a flash drive. It also has a filament runout sensor so it can, you know, say it with me, let you know when you need to run out and get more. As for speed, FlashForge lists a maximum speed of 600 millimeters per second and acceleration up to 20,000 millimeters per second squared. In practice, though, print speeds tend to top out closer to 200 to 300 millimeters per second. So all in all, it's a pretty unassuming CoreXY machine with some surprisingly capable multicolor hardware strapped to the side. It keeps things simple, it keeps things accessible, and it gives us a good foundation to see what this thing can really do once we start putting filament through it. One thing it doesn't have is a built-in camera or any onboard lighting, so if you're hoping for time lapses or remote check-ins on a print, that's something you'd need to add yourself. Getting the printer unboxed and set up was pretty simple. FlashForge says it's about a 10-minute job, but I'd call it more like 15 or 20 minutes if you've never done this before. When you open the box, the first things you see are an instruction sheet for installing the screen, along with an envelope that has the quick start guide. Unlike some other printers I've unboxed, these are right at the top, so you don't have to experience the irony of taking the printer out of the box just to find the manual that tells you how to take the printer out of the box. The super short version of the setup is basically this. Take it out of the box, snap the screen into place, attach the IFS onto the side, snap on the spool holders, then plug it in, turn it on, and go through the first run setup on the screen. You can follow along in the quick start guide or scan the QR code inside it to watch a short setup video. That first run setup also walks you through some calibration steps, including input shaping. Now, when it gets to that part, the printer can get kind of loud since it's vibrating different parts of itself to measure and compensate for those vibrations during printing. You'll also have the option to connect the printer to a Wi-Fi network, which is something I chose to do. Once all that's done, you can load filament, and that part is super simple. Snap a spool onto one of the holders, feed the filament into the appropriate input on the IFS, and it takes care of the rest, pulling the filament through the system until it reaches the toolhead. On the screen, you tell the printer what type of filament you loaded and what color it is. That information then shows up in the slicer, mostly anyway, and we'll get into that part next. One quick note about the touchscreen. Most modern 3D printers use capacitive touchscreens, but the AD5X uses a resistive touchscreen. It's an older, less expensive technology that uses a clear plastic layer to detect where you're touching. It works fine, but some of the on-screen controls are pretty small. If you've got bigger fingers, it can be a little tricky to hit the right button. Using a fingernail or even a pen with the tip retracted can make that a lot easier. Okay, on to the next section. In order to print a 3D model, we need to be able to prepare it for printing, and for that, we need a slicer. FlashForge has their version of Orca Slicer, which they've dubbed Orca FlashForge. It looks and behaves pretty much exactly like Orca Slicer, so if you're familiar with that, you'll be right at home here. I downloaded it directly from FlashForge and installed it. Interestingly, the download page promises software with AI modeling features built in, but I don't see anything like that in the version I got from that page. Anyway, with Orca FlashForge installed, I set about adding the printer to it, which was as simple as selecting the AD5X from a list of printers. Orca FlashForge can also control the printer, send print jobs to it, and monitor its progress, all via a network connection. So the next step was telling the software to connect to the printer. This part started out pretty easy. In the Device tab, I clicked the plus button, and the software saw the AD5X on the local network. But when I clicked the AD5X in the list, the software said, "Please log in first." It seems that in order to send print jobs and monitor the printer's progress with Orca FlashForge, the printer has to be bound to a FlashForge account. Not a huge issue and not completely unexpected. Some printer manufacturers do this, some don't. So, I created an account and logged into the slicer, and then I was able to add the printer in the Device tab. The filament I loaded into the printer earlier was showing up correctly, which was pretty cool. But over in the Prepare tab, I still needed to get the filament information added. So I looked for a way to synchronize the filaments that the Device tab knew about, but I didn't see anything like that. I had to manually add each filament and set its type and color. It's not a huge inconvenience, but I've seen the feature available in other slicers, and I hoped FlashForge had it as well. And this is one of the places where the workflow feels a little more hands-on than you might expect. Some multicolor ecosystems can automatically sync the printer's filament type and color information directly into the slicer's Prepare tab, which really smooths out day-to-day use. Orca FlashForge doesn't do that yet, so multicolor setup takes a few extra steps. Anyway, I wanted to print a Benji, since that's kind of a traditional first print. So I added one to the build plate and set its filament to the color I wanted. I clicked Slice Plate to slice the model, then Print Plate to send the job to the printer. Remember when I had to add each filament and set its type and color? There was no way to actually map those over to slots on the IFS. In this version of Orca FlashForge, only the Device tab really knows which filament is mapped to which IFS slot. So I had to map the filament color to the correct IFS slot in the Send Printing Task dialog box. Then I was able to send the print job. Once the printer had it, the slicer switched back to the Device tab so I could keep an eye on the progress. So after all that logging in and clicking and mapping, the only thing left was to find out how the printer actually performs. Let's take a look at some test prints. Here's the Benji I sent to the printer. I sliced it using standard settings at 0.2 millimeter layer height, and it took about 41 minutes to print. The filament is FlashForge's Marsala PLA. It's like a dark purple with a bit of bluish glitter dust in it. The Benji came out pretty good. There's a little bit of stringing in the wheelhouse, but it's just a few little wispy bits. Overall, there's really nothing to complain about here. Like other single-nozzle, multicolor printers, this printer produces purge pellets, so I needed something to get those around to the side where I could collect them. I grabbed this poop chute from FlashForge's site and printed it using standard settings at 0.2 millimeter layer height. Print time was just over 7 hours. This was printed in FlashForge's burnt titanium PLA. It's a dark blue with some glitter mixed in. It works great at directing the purge poops into the bin, but if you're going to be printing something with a lot of color changes, which means a lot of purging, you might find yourself emptying it every hour or two. As far as print quality goes, it doesn't look too bad. There are some ripples in the surface finish, especially on the front, where it looks more like ringing than anything else. And there's a bit of wispy, cobwebby stringing in parts of the zigzag section. Since this is meant to be a functional print, though, I'm not super concerned about that. This is a cube lamp by designer Sevro on MakerWorld. I printed it using standard settings at 0.2 millimeter layer height, again, using the Marsala PLA. This is the smaller of the two available sizes. The base and the slotted outer section took about 2.5 hours to print, and the diffuser took another hour, so about 3.5 hours total. The main issue here is not that it's some kind of retraction torture test for the extruder, it's really the geometry of the model. The box's walls are thin, and the cutouts are thin too. Once the print reaches a certain height, those sections can flex as the nozzle moves. That gives you a rough, uneven surface finish because the part itself is moving slightly while it's being printed. I think printing this with supports enabled could help stabilize those wobbly sections and give a better result. The geometry of this model is more challenging than I originally expected. The internal lighting is a color-changing LED puck the same size as the white LED pucks Bamboo Lab sells for their lamp kits. I'll put a link to the one I used down below. This is a flexi-style knitted articulated fox by designer Smoggy 3D on MakerWorld. I use standard settings at 0.2 millimeter layer height. Despite setting the flushing amount close to the maximum when switching from black to orange, there's noticeable color bleeding. I printed 3 at one time to reduce the per model waste, but the bleeding was still pretty significant. Print time was about 7.5 hours. Despite that, the print turned out well. All of the articulated parts move the way they're supposed to, and it's a really cute design. Given how much the black bled into the orange, I printed one more fox using a different black filament and setting the flushing value to the absolute maximum of 999 cubic millimeters, just to rule that out. About 5.5 hours later, I had my answer. It helped, but didn't completely eliminate the bleeding. At this point, it makes me think I'm running into the limits of the current purge behavior rather than something I'm doing wrong. Now it's time for the likes, dislikes, and improvements part of the video. I'll start with the things I like. Getting the printer ready right out of the box was easy. Attach the screen, attach the IFS, snap on the spool holders, and you're basically ready to go. When the printer's idle and the nozzle is cool, it's silent. No fan noise, no background hum, nothing. The spring-loaded spool rewinders don't take up all the slack when you unload filament to remove a spool, but during normal printing and color swaps, they work just fine. And those color swaps themselves worked without issue. I didn't run into any problems with the IFS changing or feeding filament. I also didn't see any major print issues that weren't a result of challenging model geometry. The cube lamp is a good example with those tall, skinny sections that can flex as the nozzle moves. In hindsight, using supports could likely have helped here. Now let's get into what I don't like, and I'll suggest improvements as I go in case FlashForge is watching. First off, that touchscreen. It's not a bad screen, but the user interface elements are on the smaller side. Using a plastic stylus or a fingernail can help when you're trying to hit a tiny on-screen button. Larger touch targets would make it more comfortable to use. When a print job is sent with leveling enabled, the printer probes the entire bed instead of just the area where it's actually going to print. I know other printers can do this more selectively, so if FlashForge could implement that, it would save a little time at the start of each print. One other little thing that bugged me was the placement and routing of the toolhead cable. It comes out of the top of the printer at the back. Bringing it out near the IFS would let it clip cleanly to the PTFE tubes. Also, the original clip broke easily, so a stronger or thicker plastic part would be welcome. As it is, I used a couple of zip ties to fix it. I couldn't completely get rid of the filament color bleed on the FlexiFox. Even with max flushing, the black still bled into the orange. I tried a different black filament and pushed the flushing volume all the way up, and while that helped a little, it didn't fully solve it. At this point, it makes me think I'm just bumping up against the limits of how the current purge behavior works. Finally, it's a bit loud during printing, mostly because there's no enclosure to muffle the sound. That's not really a flaw, just something to keep in mind if you're used to quieter, enclosed printers. So, time to wrap this up. The build volume is on the smaller side, but the price is still appealing for a CoreXY printer with 4-color capability included. There are other 4-color options at this price point that use different motion systems or offer more automation. But if you specifically want a CoreXY machine and an entry point into multicolor printing, the AD5X ends up being a pretty reasonable option. So, that's the FlashForge AD5X. Thanks again to FlashForge for sending this over so we could get a look at it. Thank you for watching, and big thanks to everyone who supports the channel, whether with channel memberships or by using the links in the description. If you liked this episode, give it a thumbs up and maybe subscribe so you don't miss new ones. Well, 3D printing friends, that's about all the time we have for this one. And now that we're at the end, let's go print something cool.